everyone. My name is Jason Merkel, and I'm a brand manager here at Horizon Hobby. And I'm joined today by the world-famous Matt Andron, who is the product developer that was responsible for the design and development of the original Timber Stole airplane, our Park Flyer version.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
What we call the, I guess, the original. So
right,
to speak.
1.5 yeah. meter version.
1.5
right.
meter
right.
version,
right.
Yep, yep. So talk a little bit more about the design of that airplane. We have never had really anything like that in our lineup before. And
right.
what made it different?
Well, you know, I've been a big fan of Stole airplanes. High lift devices have been my whole life, and really into just short takeoff and landing airplanes. So when I got the opportunity to design kind of a custom short takeoff and landing airplane, you know, I wasn't inhibited by any, you know, trying to match a full size airplane,
mm-hmm.
trying to make it look like a Cub or an Aviate Husky or anything like that. I could really kind of do whatever I felt was necessary to make it the best possible Stole airplane.
Right. Yeah, and so I think the proportions of Timber are a little bit different than your average airplane. We've got a longer but narrower chord wing,
right.
long tail moment, large stab,
right,
and
right.
that allows it to fly differently than similar sized airplanes.
Exactly.
So, like the
exactly.
regular Apprentice is about the same size, but the shape is a little bit different. It's a little bit more traditional.
Right,
but this
right.
can take off and land in shorter distances. You can turn it around in shorter distances.
Oh,
you can
much,
fly
yeah.
it slow. I'm shocked at how slow you can fly the larger one.
Right.
And that allows you to fly it in areas you never really flew before.
Exactly.
So that kind of airplane, I know I've seen guys. There's that video where the guy lands on his pool.
Yep. Yeah.
I was blown away by that. I could not believe he did that. I was really impressed. Now he'll have an even better option.
Exactly.
To take off and land from his pool. So we'll get to this in a minute. But the Timber is doing extraordinarily well. People love it.
Right.
And I think it's because anybody can enjoy it. If you have very little experience, you can turn on Safe Select, and if you've flown anything at all, you can fly that successfully.
Absolutely.
You turn that off though, and it's aerobatic capable. It's got almost enough power to hover. With the right battery, you can hover. And I think that a lot of people enjoy that really wide performance envelope.
Absolutely.
And then the fact that it doesn't have bad habits.
Exactly. Yeah.
So
it's
it doesn't
very,
bite you.
Yeah, it's very friendly. Doesn't really have any tip stall tendencies or anything like that. You know, with the leading edge slats on, it really helps, you know, really get it slow, keep authority over the ailerons and flaps,
mm-hmm.
even at the lowest airspeeds.
Well, and I remember, so about a year ago we came out with that,
yep.
and just a few months after that, watching people's response to it. People were so excited by the
exactly.
performance. They loved the airplane so much. We talked about doing the Ultra Micro. So,
right.
you know, the baby Timber, the little Timby, the little Timmy. And so basically we have it now, which
yep.
is really exciting. And some people have already pointed out that it's on the larger size wingspan-wise relative to our other Ultra Micros.
Right.
But
right.
we just talked about the reason for that. It's because of the proportions of a Timber. It's
exactly.
different. Longer, narrow chord wing. Which makes it a little bit larger, I guess, overall, but it's still ultra micro size.
Exactly. It uses the same components, 3,000 kV motor, so you
mm-hmm.
got the really good performance there, linear servos. You know, with that additional wing span, you get more wing area, which lowers
mm-hmm.
the wing loading and makes it fly that much lighter.
Yeah, and that's one thing I wanted to point out, too, is that some people have referenced the weight, but even though the weight is higher relative to some of the other ultra micros, you have more wing area. You've got the lower wing loading.
Exactly.
And so basically, in the end, the airplane is still able to fly slower,
right.
take off in a shorter distance, land in a shorter distance, and I believe, even though it's physically a little bit larger, you could fly it still in smaller spaces.
Absolutely.
And you could fly something like, say, the Ultra Micro J3.
Yeah, and that's a perfect example. When we were actually doing the development of this, we went out and flew the J3 and this side-by-side,
mm-hmm.
and the J3 was struggling to fly slower. This thing, you could just cruise around and very comfortably fly at a speed that was significantly slower than the J3.
Yeah, what I like about this is I've seen guys fly the big Timber, the original Timber, in their backyard.
Yep.
And it's tight, of course, but they're like, oh man, it's just unbelievable you can do this. Of course, now this thing will be at home in a backyard or in
right.
a front yard or in a cul-de-sac or
yep.
at a park. You can fly it just about anywhere, and that's what I really am excited about is the fact that we now have an airplane that is large enough that it's going to be able to handle some wind, and at the same time, it's actually small enough that you'll be able to fly it, and it can fly slow enough that you fly it in an extremely tight area you wouldn't have
flown
it in.
Absolutely.
So.
You know, the kind of the cool thing about this airplane is during the development and even when we shot the video, it's almost a challenge to find places you can take off and
mm-hmm.
land. You're looking in places you've never expect before. You
yeah.
know, you're looking under trees and, you know, you find a little spot of dirt in the open field. You're like, I can land on that. I can take off on that. And so it really opens up some areas that you just never expected to fly RC from before.
Well, and part of the reasons for that is, of course, you mentioned, at least when it comes to takeoff, the 3,000 kV motor.
Right.
So we put in our hotter motor.
Exactly.
We've got the large tires
yep.
out
yep.
of the box already on it. And basically that allows you to get off of you know, rougher surfaces that you wouldn't be able to get off of. In fact,
exactly.
in the video, we show some pretty thick grass
yeah,
that you're getting out of.
It was pretty much typical park grass. You know,
mm-hmm.
you kind of had to find that right spot where once it gets rolling and you can get off of pretty thick stuff. I mean, stuff that even traditional park flyers and like our 1.2 meter warbirds right. would have trouble getting off on, this can take off on.
Yeah, that's actually really cool. So that opens the door to a ton of possibilities. Of course, one of the other really cool possibilities is the ability to put floats on.
Correct.
So out of the box, it does not come with floats.
Right.
The larger timber does.
Yes.
But this one, it doesn't, because we know a lot of people already have these floats.
Exactly.
So we don't want to charge a little bit extra, because if a guy's already got a set laying around, no problem. It goes right on, right? I don't even think you have to modify anything. You don't have to have any new parts, no new struts, right?
The airplane actually comes with the additional strut.
Ah, okay.
The one additional strut you need to mount to the fuselage and get it in the correct position. But other than that, that's the only thing you need other than the float set. And you can see the two float mounts right there in the bottom, front and rear, just like the J3 and like the old Carbon Cub used the same float set. So it mounts very similar to those aircraft.
Yeah, very, very cool. So it's a simple installation. It's a quick installation. It's a low-cost upgrade. I think it was roughly $20. And it opens the door to just being able to fly, I think, literally off of a lot of people's pool.
Absolutely.
And if you don't have a pool, a pond. And if you don't have a pond, you're going to find water probably somewhere.
A good-sized puddle somewhere. Yeah.
Yeah, actually, that would be cool. We probably
Absolutely.
Should do that the next time it rains. We should go find ourselves a puddle out in the parking lot. But some other really cool things about it is it's got basically the same overall size, shape, and proportions of the larger timber, just scaled down. But
Correct.
One thing you did do is you increased the size of the flaps and the ailerons, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Did that.
You know, with the larger airplane, just the wing loading and stuff, the way it flies. With the smaller scale, you needed the larger surfaces, and that gives you a little bit more aerobatic performance as well in terms of roll. It's a
mm-hmm.
little bit crisper in roll. Had a
yeah.
little bit higher roll rate. The larger flaps, because they're not slotted like the larger timber,
yeah.
I wanted to increase the area to make sure that it was giving, you know, the
effectiveness.
Max amount of lift possible for the size of the wing and give that same feel as the larger airplane.
Got it. And then one thing you did not enlarge was the leading edge slats, right? Those
Correct.
Are basically scaled down, and they do not come installed out of the box.
Right, right.
So like the larger timber, you have the choice. You can
Yes.
leave them off. If you leave them off, you've got a little bit better roll rate. You've got a little bit faster and longer takeoff and landing.
Correct, and a little bit better inverted performance. You know, if you're looking for more aerobatic type of flying, you know, the slats just really don't like to work upside down. So
I know you have to glue them on.
Yes.
Kind of a bummer. So if you decide to put them on, it's not really permanent, though. I think you could cut them off if you wanted to.
Yeah, I mean, they're very small plastic pads. If you used a small amount of glue, you could easily probably pop them off and, fly without them for a while. But I think, this type of airplane, its purpose is short takeoffs and landings. So most people will put them on because that gives you the maximum amount of performance out of the airplane.
Yeah, plus they look cool. It's just a neat feature to see on an airplane, especially this size.
Exactly.
And I guess let's talk about that. Some people were thinking, oh, it's not going to have any impact. It really is going to make no noticeable difference. But it does, right?
It does. It's surprising how even slats this small affect the airplane. With them on, you can get it a little bit higher alpha,
mm-hmm.
and it holds it there, and it just feels more stable and more locked in going as slow as possible. This airplane, you can actually fly it with basically full back elevator, the flaps down, just modulating power to keep that angle up and steer with rudder and ailerons. So you can really get it slow, really just kind of, like you were mentioning, carve around turns in a really tight area.
Yes.
I mean, you can almost turn around within the width of this table with a lot of rudder, if you do kind of a
right.
rudder snap turn type of thing. So, it allows you to fly in just areas you would never think to fly before.
Yeah, so that's really cool. So we've got a larger ultra micro, which can handle some wind. It's got a lot of power, so it can cut through it. It has AS3X, of course,
yes.
on all the time. And then that kind of leads into the next thing, is we do actually have safe select in this, just
Correct.
Like the Big Brother.
Exactly.
And this is our only second ultra micro now that has safe select.
Right.
We had the Cessna,
yes.
which we released late last year. And a lot of people love that. They're like, wow, you could learn to fly on this thing.
Absolutely.
Which actually is true. Honestly, almost anything that has safe in it, you could literally learn to fly. You
yes.
got the bank angle limits. And you've got the pitch angle limits.
Right.
And then you also have self-leveling.
Exactly.
Right? So when you let
exactly.
go of the stick, it self-levels. So some experienced guys, people who have flown for 30, 40 years, are like, I don't need that crap. It's a bunch of crap. That's fine.
Right.
And that's why we make it safe select.
Exactly.
If you
want
to use it.
Yeah, it's just a matter of stick positions and flipping a switch 5 times to select that switch on your transmitter
mm-hmm.
you want to be your safe select activation switch. And if you don't want to use it, you don't have to go through that process. And if you do, you just, like I said, simple stick motions and then flip the switch you want to assign it to.
So it's easy to assign it. It's easy to not use it if you don't want. But even as an experienced pilot myself, I've been flying for almost 30 years now. I don't see any reason to not have it.
Right.
So
right.
it's nice, because let's say somebody comes up to me at the park and I'm like, hey, you want to try it? I flip safe on and hand them the transmitter.
Absolutely.
I'd have no qualms with that. And at the same time, if it's really windy or
yeah.
if I'm having a hard time with orientation or something, just flip the switch.
Exactly.
And get my bearings and bring it in for a nice, easy, smooth landing without me having to do all the work of keeping
right.
it level and on track.
Absolutely.
So safe is really not something that we see as a hindrance. We really see it as something that helps people, even experienced pilots, to succeed in moments where they may not have otherwise.
Right.
And so some some people have made the argument that, well, SAFE dumbs down the hobby for people. It makes it too easy to fly. But, you know, for us, the point is SAFE gets you started.
Right.
It gets you that eye-hand coordination
yep.
to get used to looking at an airplane and moving your fingers down here and saying, oh, this does that, this does that, and then you turn it off.
Right.
And like our trainers, we have the intermediate mode. We don't have that here, but that's okay. You can still learn to fly this in SAFE mode.
Exactly.
Flip out of it, go to experience mode, and if you get in trouble, flip
right
back to SAFE.
Exactly.
It's like panic recovery.
Pretty much,
basically
yeah.
built in. So that's really cool. So we actually have SAFE in this. So we've got 3,000 kV motor, we've got flaps, we've got just all the options that you could possibly imagine because the big one had it.
Right.
And the other thing that we have on this, which is really unique, is lights.
Yes.
Yeah.
This is actually the, I guess you could technically say it's the third ultramicro with lights.
Oh, okay.
Because we have the original Carbon Cub had lights and flaps.
Right.
Did have the other hybrid wing in. Was a little bit heavier airplane. You had the
yes.
full clear cockpit inside there, so that added some weight. Didn't have the Tundra tires, so you know it was a little bit limited in what you could take off mm-hmm. and land on. And then the other airplane was the Night Vapor, which,
Night Vapor
probably does this have beaten slow speed, but definitely not quite the same type of aircraft. So
I have seen a couple guys bring up the old Carbon Cub in particular.
Right.
So we don't have one here to compare to, but it's roughly about 2/3 the size, right?
Yeah,
so
the span is quite a bit smaller. Fuselage is a little bit shorter. It's just a smaller, kind of heavier loaded airplane.
And that actually had an undercambered wing,
correct?
Right?
Yeah.
This has a full airfoil
right.
wing, which I think actually I feel like it handles better, especially in the wind in
yes.
particular.
Yeah, it's just it's a more natural feeling airfoil, especially mm-hmm. during aerobatics like that. It doesn't have as much pitch tendencies
right.
And things like that. So it just makes it a truer flying airplane. And then you know with the slats and the flaps. You know, being the flaps are probably double, if not even more, than the Carbon Cub, it definitely allows you to fly a lot slower than that, and fly it slower comfortably.
Yeah, we discontinued that airplane a few years ago, and I know some people still have them and like that airplane, but I think this is an upgrade.
Absolutely.
Without a doubt, this is an improvement. And one of the really cool things is, wasn't that airplane, I think, $169
yep.
originally? And that was bind and fly.
Yeah, so that
of course, I had a battery and a charger.
Right, right, right.
You know, let's say it's a $20 value. It was still $149, and it didn't have SAFE.
Right.
It did have AS3X.
Correct.
But it also didn't have a 3,000 kV motor.
Yep.
Didn't have the large Tundra tires, of course. So there's a heck of a lot of value in this thing, just like the bigger Timber.
Yes.
Which for $250 is nothing like it.
Right.
You
right,
get
right.
floats, you get lights, you get flaps. It's a big airplane, 1.5 meter. Good strong power system, a bunch of servos. This thing is the similar kind of value.
Exactly.
And it's basically a lot of bang for your buck. $129.99 US, that's the price. $129, and that's buy and fly basic.
Correct.
So no battery, no charger.
Right.
You do need a 2-cell 280, or you can also fly it on the 200.
Yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Even though maybe some guys have the old 180s, probably would work just fine, right?
That would work. You might notice a little bit of more voltage drop when you give it full power, but it would definitely fly the airplane.
And I think there are some bigger batteries out there that might fit as well. But what is your flight time about on a 280?
On a 280, you're seeing, depending on what you're doing with the throttle, if you're doing nothing but takeoffs and landings, you know,
mm-hmm.
where you're in the power quick, but then you're off it for the landing, you
yeah.
can easily get 8 to 10 minutes. You know, pretty hard flying aerobatics, you're looking about 6 to 7.
Okay.
So pretty typical.
And I'm sure
times.
Somebody can milk out 15 minutes.
Oh,
if
easy.
They
if you're just
to.
Putting
around. Flight time on a relatively inexpensive, small battery. I mean, it's just so much fun to fly. You can fly it for a long time, you can fly it in tight spaces. Even if you have no experience, I think you'd be successful flying this. Well, I wouldn't say I would recommend this as a very first airplane,
right.
but if you've flown anything at all successfully,
yeah, if you
especially
have like,
a hobby zone airplane.
If you have a hobby zone sport cub, mm-hmm. this would be actually a great second airplane. You know,
yeah.
both high wings, you already have the experience with the SAFE system in the sport cub, so this would be a natural progression for you.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So this does come out of the box fully assembled, by the way.
Correct.
Right?
Yep, you don't have to do any assembly. The landing gear's already on it, motor props already on it. It's pretty much ready to go other than installing the leading edge slats if you want.
And again, it's bind and fly basic, so it's ready to bind to a Spectrum transmitter. Now, you
correct.
Mentioned the Sport Cup. Could you use the transmitter that comes with the ready to fly, that MLP-60SM?
You might be able to. I'd have to dig into that a little bit more. But, you know, truthfully, if you're going to be in this hobby, it's definitely worth to upgrade to at least a six-channel computer radio there. Just gives you a lot of options, gives you the model memories to kind of expand your hobby and allow you to kind of expand into the bind and fly area without having to worry about, ooh, do I have enough transmitter for this airplane?
Yeah, so we do recommend that. We actually say full range transmitter on the box. And so I think almost anything that's out there, though, Spectrum transmitter wise, is going to work. The old DXXI will probably work.
Absolutely.
Obviously, DX9, DX18. And then I'd say for the programming, there's really nothing to do, right? Other than maybe elevator flap mix?
There's actually, with the Safe Select on, there's a mix kind of built in there to prevent the pitch
with
up.
Safe.
Yes. Without it, you can actually fly through it pretty easy. It doesn't quite have as much pitch up as even the Park Flyer.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, you can easily just do an elevator to flat mix to mix out any pitch up there, but it is very manageable even without a mix.
You know what the percentage is off the top of your head?
Typically, it's about 15 for half flap and about 30 for full flap is a really good starting point.
Okay.
You know, depending on exactly how you set up your airplane, you know, whether your flaps are exactly the same as, you know, our particular airplane, the values might be a few points off.
Yeah.
But that's a good starting point.
Yeah, and I think density, altitude, all those things have some kind of an impact on that. But, yeah, there's nothing really to set up. It comes out of the box. You can be flying within the few minutes it takes to pull it out of the box and put a battery in.
Exactly.
And that's really, really exciting because I think even the larger Timber has a little bit of work.
Yeah,
put together.
Yeah, you have to put the gear
on.
Exactly. It's,
yeah,
it is a little bit more assembly to get it together than obviously pulling this out of the box. So
getting out of the box and into the air real quick, when are guys going to be able to get one in the box?
Well, good thing is these are already on the water, so we're hoping for right at the end of this month, so you guys won't have to wait
very long. So we're talking 3-4 weeks.
Exactly.
But that said, one thing I like to point out is that you know, a product like this, which has already a very literally we've been pre-selling it for a day now.
Yes.
And we've sold a lot.
Yeah.
More than expected. And so I'll just be honest, if you don't pre-order one now, you may not get one out of the first shipment. And just like the Big Timber, if you remember last year, I don't think we ever had them in stock until probably Christmas time, roughly.
Yeah,
so it was almost 6 months.
Coming in and going right back
out
to customers, exactly.
Guys, I heard guys were buying them on eBay for $300. They were paying extra money because they wanted one.
Right.
And they couldn't get one. So, you know, don't fall into that boat. If you want one of these Ultra Micro Timbers, make sure you get it on pre-order at your favorite dealer, your favorite online retailer, horizonhobby.com. The sooner the better you get one, the more enjoyment you're going to have from it, for sure.
Exactly.
But also make sure that you actually get your hands on one. And it's a no-brainer.
Right.
It just does everything well. It's a good size. I know it's a little bigger than our typical Ultra Micros, but you can still fly it in smaller spaces than other Ultra Micros. It has good power.
Yes.
It doesn't have quite unlimited vertical, right? But it's
not 100% unlimited vertical. It does kind of tractor uphill. You can hover it. And you know, like, you need to have pretty fresh, good batteries. You know, if your 280s are a little worn out, probably won't see the performance for a true hover. But if you have, you know, nice, fresh, good quality batteries, should be no problem.
So it's got great performance out of the box, no assembly, value is there. You got the lights, you got the flaps, you've got Safe Select, the 3000 kV motor, Tundra tires, float compatibility, which is awesome because that opens the options of where you can fly significantly.
Yep. And then easy battery access.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
Battery right in the top there, so don't have to flip the airplane over to get in there and put the battery in. And you see there's a lot of room for various size batteries in the hatch there.
Well, and this actually brings me to a point. I suspect a couple guys actually thought about this. How strong is the nose?
The nose is actually considerably strong. There's two carbon rods that you can't see that are underneath the battery tray that run all the way forward to the nose and all the way past after the wing. So
yeah.
The nose has been reinforced. So I know there was a few reports of the larger Timber having a couple of nose issues for guys who would nose over real hard or anything like that.
With power on in particular.
Right.
Yeah.
This one definitely does not have that issue.
That's cool. I was twisting it. I'm actually shocked at how stiff it is. And then I believe there's actually a battery tray in here that helps stiffen things too.
Exactly.
As well, right?
Yep.
Yeah, it's fantastic. So easy battery access, that's cool. In and out, no flipping it over. You got the lights already in there, that's fantastic. And would you say the lights are bright enough that you could fly in the dark?
I would think so. You know, I could easily imagine guys flying around their cul-de-sac or up and down the street. You know, maybe there's some ambient lighting for some houses around there or something like that. But, you know, being a white airplane, it's going to show up well even in fairly dark conditions. I mean, maybe if it's pitch black, it might be a little tricky, but...
But you've got navigation lights, so
exactly.
You know red is left, green is right.
Right. You got the landing lights off the nose. You got the kind of the imitation strobes top and bottom, or the rotating beacons top and bottom, so that'll help with orientation as well.
And worst case scenario? Flip safe on.
That's right.
You'll be all right.
Exactly.
Flip safe on, throttle off, it'll basically almost land itself, right?
Yep.
Yeah, as long as you don't hit anything. So, yeah, I think that covers it. Do we see any good questions that have come up on the feed?
You guys have answered most of them. A lot of them are like, looks cool. When can I get one to review for you guys? Somebody asked, what's the largest battery that you could put in?
I would say probably just because of physical dimensions of the batteries, something like a 300 milliamp hour.
300 to 350.
They start
probably getting
a little wide and flat and might have some issue with the width of the fuselage there.
And also CG then, because it's relatively far ahead
of
CG.
Right, yeah, you don't want to put too much weight forward, then you lose some of that slow flight ability because the airplane ends up being nose heavy. You're carrying a lot more back elevator than you would to try and get it slow.
And then you have to have more throttle to compensate, so on and so forth.
Yep,
so,
yep.
Any other questions?
Any telemetry?
On this one, it does have your basic radio signal telemetry. It does not give like a battery voltage or anything like that. It's pretty much the same telemetry you've seen in some of the previous Ultra Micros.
Yeah, down the road, I think we know that that's what guys want, and we're going to work towards that. And sometimes things like that do cost some extra money, so we're weighing those options as much as we can, and maybe down the road we'll have more telemetry options. So, any other questions?
Had a few comments. People said they've already pre-ordered theirs.
Oh,
good.
Fantastic.
One person made a comment that you better pre-order now, otherwise they're going to be gone.
And I honestly think at the rate we're going, guys, seriously, it will be gone.
What size motor?
It is the 3,000 kV 180 size motor, so it's basically the same physical size we've used on a lot of the previous Warbirds.
Mm-hmm.
I know the Ultramicro P51 uses the 3,000 kV motor. The
yeah.
new Waco uses the 3,000
yeah.
kV motor. So it's a motor we've kind of gotten to because it gives that extra little bit of power, but it's same size as previous Ultramicros. So
it's a 180 size-ish.
Yes.
Yeah. Any other questions?
Can it take a lightweight transmitter camera combo unit?
Yeah, of course, definitely. So our built-in, for example, the Spectrum camera with VTX,
yep.
no problem. Stick it right here on the nose. Stick it up here on top.
Exactly.
I don't have any issues carrying that.
Those
are 25 milliwatt.
Correct. And I could even see somebody, you know, buying a separate battery hatch and actually recessing the camera into the cockpit there, so you get even more of kind of a cockpit feel. Exactly.
Yeah. So we don't necessarily have it provisioned for FPV, but it wouldn't be hard to just splice in
right.
the power.
With a top hatch and an easy access to the board right there, you know, I didn't want to make a hole in the top of the fuselage where you're
mm-hmm.
mounting camera. I figured there's enough options with the front hatch. It makes it easy to mount. So
yeah, and I think it'll be a great FPV airplane. Really, anything with safe as an
exactly.
option is a great FPV airplane. If you get disoriented, flip a switch.
Or just fly around
and
safe. You know, that way you have the self-leveling.
Landed and safe. Oh,
you just
so
don't have
easy.
To worry about it. It's just more of a guiding around the sky, and you just enjoy the view you're getting from the first person view. So.
Exactly. Anything else?
One other comment they asked, how much is the ready-to-fly package? We don't have a ready-to-fly package.
We don't. We actually only offer this in a bind-to-fly basic package. And the reason for that is, although you could learn to fly on it, and with Safe-On in particular, we still don't consider it a trainer.
Right.
You know, we've got a lot of great hobby zone airplanes, like the Ultramicro T28 that we just announced
yep.
and released.
Yep.
It's phenomenal. The Sport Cub S that you mentioned, the
exactly.
Champ S Plus.
Yeah.
We've got a lot of what we consider maybe better training,
correct.
Teach yourself to fly options. But that said, if you can fly any of those successfully, you can fly this.
Absolutely.
And the nice thing is, let's say you buy a Champ S Plus, $169.99. The battery from that will work in this. The
yep.
charger will work for
yep.
it. The transmitter, we talked about that. It's not full range, so it wouldn't necessarily be recommended. But yeah, I think if you already have a transmitter and you already flown anything, it's a great choice. Bind-to-fly basic.
One last question that popped up. I don't know if they're just trying to quiz you, Matt. What's the part number?
EFLU 3950.
Yeah, so. Even I know it now. In fact, I saw the thread on RC groups. They put the item number in the description.
Yep, exactly.
You know, it's probably better because then when people Google search for it, they'll find that thread. So, yeah, on RC groups, again, there's a thread there as usual. If you guys have any other questions, feel free to post them here on Facebook. Check out the thread on RC groups.
Absolutely.
Check out our website, e-flightrc.com, to see more information. You can also pre-order at www.horizonhobby.com,
yep.
your favorite retailer, online retailer, or at your favorite local hobby shop. Again, get your pre-order in. Otherwise, you're going to miss it. It's going to be Christmas time. You're not going to know if you're going to get one.
Yeah.
You don't want that to happen. You want to get this thing end of this month. And be flying it while actually still the weather's warm.
Yep, absolutely.
Even when it's not warm. Oh, by the way, that actually brings me to a point. Are there any skis that would fit?
Not necessarily anything that's out there manufactured at this point, but
it'd be easy to make some, right?
Very simple, even a piece of plastic, and you could just bend up. Even heck, you could probably even make it out of like a 2-liter soda bottle plastic,
mm-hmm.
and then
with
just
already some curvature to it.
Yeah, and then just use a little bit of you know, plywood or balsa to make some sort of an axle support and something to mount on the actual axle there.
That's cool. Actually,
we should
do that. Winter time comes. Although it didn't snow a lot here last year, so I guess we will see. But yeah, I think that covers everything, guys. Thanks for joining us today, and we're really, really excited about this. Again, the brand new eFlight Ultramicro Timber. Get your pre-order in right away. Thank you very much, Matt.
Absolutely.
This is going to be a phenomenal product for a lot of people.